For many of us, Thanksgiving is about the meal, turkey, cranberry sauce, all kinds of good things like that. And that's a good thing. We should not be ashamed of realizing that it's around the meal and that we draw close to have intimacy with each other and God. And I'll be honest with you. Have you ever seen that commercial where the guy's going for a firing squad? And they ask him what the last thing he is he would like to eat. And he says he wants a pizza. You know? Well, if I was getting ready to get electrocuted or firing squad or whatever, they ask me what my last meal would be. It would be turkey dressing and cranberry sauce. And my second to last meal would be grits and eggs and bacon. I tell you, man, when you know priorities, right? But then, you know, what are our priorities? Well, as soon as Thanksgiving is over with, people will begin to think about shopping and things like that and getting together at Christmas time. But we would hopefully think that and encourage you to let the Thanksgiving, let it sink in and understand how important it is to give thanks. You know, this year is the 400th anniversary of something that happened very special about 400 years ago. Don't seem to be getting a whole lot of attention, sadly. You know what that was? That's right. They found a compact and their arrival when they came there. Now, this is a little bit of reading on it, and it wasn't the first time anybody came to this continent. There's a lot of things about history, a lot of things. And we need to study history so we can know about the good and the bad. But there is a lot of good there to be discerned and things like that. And the meal, from what I understand, consisted of venison, perhaps turkey, but mostly wild boar fowl, and different sauces and different things like that. There were 90 Indians there, and there were like 42 or 45 pilgrims there. So, in a way, the pilgrims were outnumbered. Now, I came across something that I thought was kind of interesting. They said that, you know, a lot of us think that that was a time of like goodwill, and perhaps it was, but one person wrote that the reason why the Indians showed up is they heard the pilgrims shooting off the cannons and muskets, so they showed up to check out, see what was going on, and they decided to sit down and kind of eat and talk about things and stuff like that. Okay, it is what it is, you know. But the first child born in that community, or actually born on the Mayflower, was named Humility Cooper, you know. So that shows you that the pilgrims were, and they went through a hard time on that ship over here. I mean, you know, now somebody said that so many people claim kinship to the pilgrims that came over here that you think that ship was as big as an aircraft carrier, but it was a small ship. I wouldn't have the intestinal fortitude or guts to get on a boat like that across the Atlantic, but they did. They lived off of very meager rations and encountered all kinds of storms and things like that. But, you know, I think that one of the things that I say about Thanksgiving is, we get into the scriptures and see what the scriptures have to say about it, is I have found, almost without exception, that people that live pleasant, thankful people. Talk to Miss Sally sometimes. She's thankful that we don't have to shovel any snow. I mean, she's just a sweet lady. And she's always got a smile. And you know, I'm still here, you know. And this Miss Frances Connors, you know, she's such a wonderful person to talk to. You can sense it. These are people that have really enjoyed life. They've been through some difficult times. They've seen difficult times. Imagine 100 years ago, I mean, it was just a few years before 1920, the Titanic sank. You know? Isn't that something? I think somebody wrong. But then they have such a wonderful attitude. And you never hear them really complain. They just have to embrace whatever's coming their way. Gratitude to God, thankfulness to God, honors Him, but it's also good for us to do. In the Old Testament, God used the sacrificial system that teaches people to be grateful. And he established the Hebrews as a nation. He gave them very specific, as was read in Leviticus, instructions on how to be thankful. He wanted them to know that the most important things about life was this, is that he wanted them to know the truth about God, who God is holy. That's the most important thing. God is above and beyond. He's transcendent, although he's always present. He's all-powerful, and he's in everything. He is separate. We do not worship the stars and the moon and animals and whatever. That's good. It's okay to appreciate things, but it's important to see that it is God's handiwork, and it speaks of his glory. And the idea that a creator that created all that and created us, that is so profound. And we can know that. We know that truth, and that's what he wanted them to know. And he wants us to know through the Bible. And that will affect the way we look at life and give you an appreciation of things. Also, he wants us to know the truth is that we are sinful. We have fallen. We have done, in the beginning, wrongful things. And sin came into the human race and the human heart. And because of that, we need salvation. He's given us a free will for all things. My dad used to always say that God must think an awful lot of free will, because when he gave it to us, he must have known that things were not going to go good. But we are not robots, okay? And I'm very glad that I'm not a robot, okay? I mean, that would be a very dreary existence, okay? Now, he also wants us to know that obedience is essential. In order to be thankful, very essential part of being obedient to God. The Lord taught us in the sacrificial system that all these things that we just mentioned are true and they still apply to us today, and we should on a daily basis be thankful to God. And also it's important to understand that the sacrificial system that was in the Old Testament pointed towards the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And we no longer have to make animal sacrifices and go through that. There was a reason for teaching the Hebrew people about sin and death and life, and that, because that's a reality. But Jesus and his sacrifice and put an end to sacrifices. Now what we have is a sacrifice of obedience to God. And the obedience, no matter what, okay? No compromises. How do you follow the example taught by the daily sacrifice of thanksgiving? Well, one way is we take simple note of the many, many blessings that God provides for us each day. Think of some blessings each day. Anybody want to volunteer a blessing that they have? Hey, that's very important. That was when I was going to close. You know, took it. No, you're right. We woke up. That's good. They're alive. We got a car to drive, transportation. Most of us got a job, had a job. Most of us have adequate financial resources. Okay? We have all these medical technologies that can help us and help our loved ones get a better quality of life. Unfortunately, we take these things for granted. We tend to lapse into that. One of the blessings that I enjoy in my life is that when I come over here to the church, I can hear the little blessings at school over there, the little children giggling and laughing and carrying on. And it's such a joy to hear that. I mean, that's like music. It really is. It's good. Okay? It's also important that we have a heart and mind focused upon the Lord. By daily giving thanks to God and appreciating life and developing that attitude of thankfulness, that helps us stay focused upon what's important in life. Okay? Quite often we can get caught up in a swamp and quagmire of all the different worries and woes and problems that we have. And that just doesn't do us any good. It makes us miserable. And also, we kind of become no good for others around us. Okay? How many people here like to be around somebody who complains all the time? No. I'm pretty good at getting away from that real fast, you know. Then I keep thinking, well, we got to try to help that person out. Then I got to realize I don't need to be like that either. It's easy to get kind of sucked into that kind of thing. But it's important that thankfulness honors God. It exalts Him, lifts Him up. And that's what we're supposed to be doing, especially in our worship. And it's a way to just enrich life and make it so much better. And thankfulness to God can be expressed in a lot of different ways. Can you think of a way that we can express our thankfulness to God? What about gathering together to worship? Right? To encourage one another. And to hear other people express thankfulness. We can express our thankfulness to God by also giving to Him the first parts and first fruits of our increase in our income. You know? That's important. That's an important discipline. And tithing and stewardship is really a discipline of thankfulness. Okay? What we do is we give our first fruits to God, and we trust Him to take care and meet our needs. Okay? And that's not easy to do. Okay? It's not easy to do. Quite often we give to God in a way that it's kind of like we just tip Him, you know? No. We're supposed to put it all on God. Remember what God has done for us. He's given us many, many blessings. He chose us before the foundation of the world. We've been given the gifts and fruits of the Spirit if we follow after Him, His promises. We are given salvation. He gave His Son, okay, for us, the ultimate sacrifice. Just imagine what it must have been like to see the Son Jesus come into this world and go through the things He went through. But one day we know that every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is here. People will praise Him and thank Him, even those who did not come to know Him. Sadly, they will know that Jesus. We know that we have an eternal home. We know that we will have a body that will be resurrected and that there will be a resurrection. God has given us the hope that we will see those who have gone on before us and we will never be separated. That's going to be beautiful. To know that that dear one that we love and grieve over, you will see again and you will see them whole and healthy and not suffering. That's one of the hardest things in life. It takes a lot of soul work and spiritual growth to deal with that, believe me. God wants us to be all that we can be. We're fallen, and we tend to mess things up as we notice the way the world is right now. But at the same time, we do have a light. The sun is shining, and we have now, and we hope for being thankful. Second, the next minute, the next hour, and many, many more years. But we know that whatever tithe, whatever comes, is going to be, we have Christians, we have eternity. God has put that in us, that love, that resurrection, that power, and that Holy Spirit. So, one of the most important things to understand that God is pleased with when it comes to thanksgiving is that we have situations that are woeful. Still be able to express thanksgiving to God in those situations is one of the most powerful things, most powerful acts of love and glorifying God that He is most pleased with because He knows that purifies us and makes our hearts more like Jesus and gets us ready for the world to come. This life is a shakedown cruise for the world to come. Each and every day we're supposed to live our life in such a way that we will be more like Jesus and we will interact with one another in ways that we will interact in eternity. So very important to realize that. So think today about how we can keep the focus on the Lord. Understand that thanksgiving and having an attitude of thanksgiving affects the way we live, the quality of life that we have, and the quality of life available to this world. Okay? that makes a difference in this world. And people need us. I'd say the vast majority of the human race needs us to live and be thankful so they can see that we have hope and that there is hope. There's hope. I have something I want to share with you, if you will bear with me a little bit, and I'll try to find it. I'm not exactly a wizard when it comes to this kind of stuff, but a good friend of mine shared this with me. It's a devotional. He sends me something every day. God's presence is the present. God's presence is the present. From Ezekiel 34, 26. I will make them in the places around my field a blessing. I will cause a shower to come down in its season. There will be showers of blessing. This is here. In 1883, Daniel Webster Willard wrote, there shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasons of refreshing sent from the Savior above. And that's going to be our answer and response. This poem turned hymn was based on Ezekiel 34, 26, and 28. The passage packed with a powerful promise for God's people. Daniel Whittle knew of God's ability to shower us with blessings. He was a major in the Civil War, the side of the North, who lost his right arm and became a prisoner of war as well. While in prison, he stumbled upon a New Testament Bible and began to read it out of curiosity. That's interesting. Whittle was convicted, but was not ready to surrender to God. In God's sovereign grace, an orderly woke him up one night requesting that he pray for a dying soldier. Initially, he declined, but the orderly insisted until he went beside the dying soldier, and there he prayed for the soldier, confessing his own sins and surrendering to God. That day, God showered him with inexplicable blessings. God desires to shower you with blessings, too. In Ezekiel 34, God promises to bless his people, not only with safety and tranquility, but with his holy presence. Thus, the showers of blessing we need are found in God's presence, the greatest present. Then there's this little prayer here, so sweet. Generous God, many times I relegate your blessings to material goods, such as houses, cars, and mountains. But the greatest blessing you have given me is Jesus Christ himself. Please bless me to know you more intimately. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. That's the question this morning. We need to ask God to help us to move into a deeper, more intimate relationship with him and understand how much of a blessing in life is, how much of a blessing it is to know God and have an intimate Savior, how much of a blessing it is to have his word that we can study with the power of the Holy Spirit open our eyes to an understanding of life really and truly. And that's the word of God for the people of God. We now have our affirmation of the Christian faith, the Apostles' Creed. Let's all stand. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. I believe in the judgment of the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Showers of Go with us, Jehovah. Thank you for your many, many blessings, Jehovah. Help us always have a thankful, grateful heart, to show out that love and thankfulness and gratitude to this world, so that they will see Jesus in us, and they will follow Jesus Christ in us.